As one of the supposedly darkest epochs in human history, the Middle Ages still do not have a good reputation. In this regard, we often think of dirty farmers and villagers who were superstitious and a bit underexposed. But what was everyday life in the Middle Ages really like? To put it plainly, the people of that time were actually quite wacky in many respects. From bloody divorce battles, to animals in the dock, to deadly ideals of beauty, here are some weird medieval traditions your history teacher never told you about. Before we get started, be sure to hit the like button and ring the notification bell for more videos. Also, stick around until the end to learn about one of the most bizarre facts regarding the Middle Ages. Codpiece. It is a well-known fact that fashion has already bloomed in its most peculiar ways, and the so-called codpiece was no exception. The European gentlemen of the 14th and 15th centuries wore special pads in their crotch, which were sometimes round, but in some cases were like cucumber or banana shaped. The knights also relied fully on suitable genital protection when it came to armor. These so-called braillettes could sometimes be removed if the warrior had to relieve himself in between. In fact, it was also an effective countermeasure on the battlefield, since German pikemen had developed a habit of stabbing their enemies' previously unprotected genitals. Since the codpieces were also considered a symbol of male potency, they were heavily criticized in the ranks of the church. Some even saw the work of the devil in this sinful fashion. Ideals of beauty. In our modern day, a healthy tan is considered an attractive sign of vitality. In the 16th century, however, things were very different. Only beggars and farmers had to toil under the scorching sun. For this reason, it is considered fashionable in high society to be particularly pale. Queen Elizabeth I, who was in power from 1558 to 1603, showed how the desired pallor could be helped a little. Like so many other women, the ruler smeared white lead on herself every day. The fact that this highly toxic substance literally tore the skin, left deep scars, and probably even killed her was probably something of a necessary evil. Now, if you think that people would come to their senses a bit over the next few centuries, you're wrong. It was very desirable among women in the Victorian era to have pupils that were as large as possible. In addition, the ladies actually dripped poisonous plant extracts, such as belladonna or deadly nightshade, into their eyes. Animal processes. Attacks on children, vandalism, failure to provide assistance. It should be clear to all of us that all of these things should be punished in court. Even the judges of the Middle Ages showed no mercy in such cases. Even though the accused were sometimes animals who had absolutely no idea what was going on around them. Unbelievable but true. So-called animal trials were held well into the 17th century, in which dogs, pigs, cattle, etc. were accused and often sentenced to death. The pitiful four-legged friends were then drowned, hanged, burned, or buried alive. In 1478, cockchafers were even accused. After all, the insects got their own lawyer. If a woman had been ambushed, all animals present that had not rushed to the victim's aid had to be executed. Divorce by battle. Are you wondering how love was abolished in the Middle Ages? Then let's take a look at a German manuscript that lets us look deep into the zeitgeist of the year 1467. When two spouses accused each other of something, but there was no witnesses or confessions, the case could only be solved in one way, through a legally regulated duel. This grotesque divorce battle followed very specific rules. The man had to go into a 1 meter deep hole with one hand tied behind his back. The woman, in turn, was allowed to move about freely. Equipped with 3 clubs each, the failed couple was then allowed to thrash each other. If the rules were broken, such as touching the edge of the hole, the opponent was deprived of one of his weapons. The one who knocks his opponent out first was the winner. If the man lost, he was subsequently executed in the town square. If the woman lost, she was thrown into the dug hole on the spot and buried alive. Schnabelschuh. Anyone who literally lived big in the Middle Ages naturally wanted to put this on public display. And what could have been better suited to this than wearing extravagant shoes? Appearing in courtly fashion in the 14th century, pointed-toe shoes were almost reminiscent of pointed flippers. Over time, different dress codes came into being, which determined exactly how long the kicks could be. In view of the lack of archaeological finds, however, it is unclear to what extent the contemporary illustrations correspond to the reality of the time. From time to time, it is said that the toes of some shoes were so long that they had to be tied to the belt. However, there is no sound basis for such assumptions. Soccer. What today is thoroughly commercialized and perfectly organized lawn chess was more than a neat mass brawl in the Middle Ages. In fact, football back then didn't have much to do with the sport we have today. The fields stretched several kilometers in some cases. Matches lasted a whole day, and the round didn't have to be played in the corner, but through the city gate. When two villages fell upon each other chasing the ball, practically everything was allowed apart from murder and manslaughter, even if there were repeated fights and deaths during the games. Since the games often got completely out of control, football was officially banned again and again. In the 15th and 16th century, the Medici family then tried to bring at least some order to the hopeless chaos. From then on, only 27 players per team were allowed to compete. Jugglers and fools. Although jugglers had a firm place in medieval life, the entertainers were viewed extremely critically by the rest of the population. After all, these so-called traveling people had nothing else in mind than taking money out of people's pockets at festivals and fairs. In fact, this distrust is still reflected today in the saying, to fool someone. The fools, in turn, served at royal courts. But despite their flashy, brightly colored clothing, medieval entertainers were by no means merely seen as cheerful jesters. Accordingly, fools also had a negative reputation, as they were lumped together with criminals or even the devil. Within the framework of the freedom of fools, however, they were able to do something that no one else was granted. They were allowed to criticize the royal court. However, a distinction was made between natural and artificial fools. Natural fools, for example, were mentally handicapped or deformed people who were generally avoided. The artificial fools, who were often very intelligent, sometimes even acted as close and serious advisors to the kings. Dance mania. In the 14th and 15th centuries, large groups of people began to dance involuntarily until they collapsed, completely exhausted. To this day, we have no idea what the true origins of these strange dancing fits were all about. The attempts to explain this ranged from herbal drugs to ergot poisoning to spider bites. In order to cure the frenzy of dancing, medieval doctors relied on sweating cures and treatment with feces. High forehead. What thousands of men fear today was an ideal of beauty worth striving for in the Middle Ages. However, this only applied to the ladies of creation. In order for the forehead to appear as high as possible, the women at court shaved their hairline. When a painter was asked to portray the women, he was sometimes encouraged to paint the forehead even higher than it actually was. But what was this strange trend all about? Well, a high forehead represented a high uterus in the Middle Ages. However, it is not exactly clear why a high-lying uterus was perceived as a positive at the time. What is certain is that the inhabitants of the Middle Ages believed in a two-part womb. The girls grew on the left side and the boys on the right. When we look at old pictures of the proud women wearing foreheads, another detail catches our eye. The women had no eyelashes. Since a seductive look was associated with the women of horizontal trade, the ladies at court preferred to pluck their eyelashes and eyebrows. In the 15th century, it was particularly fashionable to paint the veins on the décolleté with artificial color. Fool's Festival. On January 1st of every year, the medieval world was turned upside down, first appearing in southern France, but later also spreading to other parts of Europe. The participants of the Fool's Festival were allowed to elect their very own false bishop or pope. Higher and lower clergymen also swapped roles, and various church rituals were parodied. Similar to modern festivals such as a carnival, it was also common at the time to wear masks and to dance provocatively. The festival acted like a short social revolution and was intended to remind the upper classes that they too could one day fall out of favor. Nobody breaks the law. Anyone who was suspected of having committed a crime in the Middle Ages had little to smile about. This is proven, among other things, by several historical documents that were made in Norway in the 13th century. In fact, a person's reputation at the time was one of the most important arguments an accused could bring up in court. As soon as the first rumors arose that a resident had broken the law, if he was unable to refute the allegations, he could be officially punished. In other words, a rumor was about as powerful as evidence. Once faced with grave allegations, a member of the community had virtually no choice but to hope for the favor of his contemporaries. The law of the time claimed that the accused had to prove his innocence with the help of testimony. If the witnesses wanted to confirm their statements, they swore an oath. Historical legal texts suggest that these vows were taken very seriously. However, these oaths were less about the circumstances of the actual crime than about the reputation of the accused in society. The relevant witnesses were often asked not whether they knew anything about the alleged sequence of events, but rather whether they considered it likely that the suspect had committed the alleged crime. While a defendant is now considered innocent before the law until proven otherwise, in the Middle Ages, it was the other way around. Here, a person was considered guilty until innocence was guaranteed by a sufficient number of oaths. However, if a person on trial had no friends or family to swear by his reputation, the process was practically resolved before it even began. Judas Cradle. It is well known that the medieval courts used far more drastic measures to force the accused to confess. A wide variety of cruel torture instruments have been developed for this purpose. During this time, the suspects were subjected to hellish torture. In order to end the excruciating pain, many of the accused let themselves be carried away to confess, even though they were actually innocent. The Judas Cradle was one of the most brutal torture devices of the Dark Ages. It was a pyramid-shaped wooden device, on the top of which the victim was placed by means of a winch. The sharp end of the Judas Cradle was inserted into the nether regions of the victim, regardless of whether or not they were truly innocent. This means that, according to the law of the Middle Ages, any of us could have been subject to this punishment without even doing anything wrong. During the interrogation, the accused were repeatedly pulled up and then dropped. This cruel process resulted in serious abdominal injuries. Sometimes heavy weights were placed on the victim's legs to add to the agony. In order to make the horror of this torture instrument even more diabolical, it was never washed after the respective interrogations. Those who unexpectedly survived the torture were confronted not only by unbearable pain, but also with potentially deadly infections. Tiny people. If we look at the sperm cell under a microscope, the sperm cells look more like tiny tadpoles than a sort of human being. But did you know that well into the 18th century, many scientists firmly believed that sperm contained fully developed miniature humans? Obviously, at the time, microscopes were not common, if they were even available at all. Because of this, scientists had to make their best estimate about what would have been contained in the slippery substance. In the context of this idea, which was referred to as preformationism, people believed that once the tiny human being entered the womb, they simply grew larger and larger, instead of being fundamentally created there. While we now know that the development of an embryo is completely different, the belief in preformationism shaped the world of scientists for many decades. This idea is a true testament to the state of the scientific community back then. All those years ago, scientists believed they had figured out almost everything about our existence. However, now that hundreds of years have passed by, we realize that scientists were terribly wrong. This truly makes you wonder what scientists may be like in a few more hundred years, and begs the question, what else could we be wrong about right now that is commonly accepted as true? Which tradition from back then surprised you the most? And would you like to live in the Middle Ages for a day? Let us know your thoughts, suggestions, and feedback on today's video in the comments below. Also, while you're at it, don't forget to give us a thumbs up and subscribe to stay up to date from now on. Finally, feel free to take a look at other posts on our channel which you can access by clicking on one of the pictures in the credits. And with that, thanks for watching, have a good one, and see you next time.